Good afternoon and welcome to the Alex Urbina Radio Show. We're broadcasting live from downtown Newhall, California, right here in your hometown station, KHTS. Joining me in studio today, we have my lovely co-host, Ellen Tunick, and we have my son, Mark Urbina. Thank you both for being here today. I appreciate you taking the time.
Absolutely.
Of course.
So today I want to talk a little bit about fear and how fear stops most of us from really taking on the challenges that are going to bring us the greatest rewards in life. And so today I'm really talking about interpersonal fear, not the kind of fear that's going to be stopping us from, you know,
facing, like bungee jumping.
Yeah, facing danger. You know, right? You know, and so I want to talk a little bit about that. So I want to start off the show with the possibility that fear is a choice. And I say a possibility because not everybody has gotten to that stage where they've decided for themselves that fear could possibly. Because it feels in those moments like you have no choice. It just, fear almost like just is a reaction. It's almost like it overcomes us, it paralyzes us. So it's very hard to wrap our mind around the possibility that fear can be a choice. But I'm going to speak about it anyways, as though it is. Because for me in my journey, I'm starting to get more clarity every day that I choose fear. And the more that you become more conscious and aware that it can be a choice and that it is a choice, you actually start finding moments where you can choose to not have the fear. But you got to really understand that. And so that's why I thought this topic would be important to discuss. So if fear is a choice, I want you to imagine that fear only exists in your mind, right? That it's in your thoughts that fear exists, and that it's a byproduct of our imagination, of what we believe might happen or what we visualize. The worst case scenario, something that happens inside your imagination, in your mind. And a lot of times fear happens when we're not in the present moment. We're up in our head, in our mind, thinking about a future example or a future scenario or a possibility that might happen. So if that's the case and it's something that happens in our mind, are we not conscious enough to be able to decide to either shut it down or come up with a different possibility in our mind that doesn't cause fear to occur?
I process this every day of my life. And I can fully intellectualize what you are saying.
That's great. That's a starting point.
And when it happens to me, because it happens every single day, I know intellectually that I am making this choice, that my fear, you know, one of my greatest fears is creating chaos. Mm. It's very difficult for me to create chaos. I run from chaos. So my fear of saying what's really on my mind to certain people, I can't get over it. I can't seem at this point in time, I'm working on it, to break through it and be the spontaneous person that I would like to be, where I feel free to say what I'm feeling.
Great. Thank you for sharing that. It seems like when people share the things that they're afraid of, in this example, you're afraid of, maybe you said chaos. But what I'm thinking that's a little bit deeper than the chaos is the confrontation that might come from chaos,
right? I think
it's
like the judgment.
It's the fear that someone is going to walk out and leave, that I lose a relationship, I won't be able to respond if they, you know, come at me. Mm. I mean, it's a multitude. It's layered for me. And it seems to always center around not being able to say what's on my mind to certain people.
Yeah.
Not everybody. Some people, it's like, certain people, like within family.
But here's something I want to point out to you just from the outside looking in. And sometimes that's when we have our biggest breakthroughs, is when somebody else points something out to us that we can't see because we're in the inside. You can say whatever's on your mind. So it's not like you can't.
Right. I'm choosing not
You're
to.
You're choosing not to because you create a scenario in your mind, right?
Yeah.
This is where the imagination comes in. And then in your mind, there's this imaginary scenario of how people are going to react. Now, when it comes to all of those reactions that I'm going to call them negative reactions, because I'm sure
yeah.
the positive ones, you're not saying, no, I don't want that
oh,
to
yeah.
happen, right?
Yeah.
So it's mainly the negative reactions that are going to come out of how you choose to just be in your life. Now, those negative reactions, I need you to be open to the possibility that you're in a psychological resistance to those things showing up.
100%.
You haven't accepted, first of all, that you cannot control other people's reactions. And this always goes back to the things that we can control and the things that we can't control. And there's a part of your ego that wants to be in control of the way people react to you.
I don't want people to be mad at me.
Exactly. And you just put words to
such a weenie.
You put words to the statement that symbolizes what your main fear is
yes.
I don't want people to be mad at me. And as long as you live from that place, you cannot have the freedom to be who you decide to be in your life. You're not going to experience
very conflicting.
You're not going to experience the joy of just of being free.
Yes.
Free to be you and to say you and to be you and to
free to
choose
be me.
You. Yeah, you're not free yet because you still have the fears that stop you based on how people are going to choose to respond to that. And the fact that you're having the courage to even share with us today is part of the process. It's through conversations like this that your awareness starts to get deeper and you start to understand it more. And what I've noticed is the more you talk about it, the little further on down the road you get until one day, all of a sudden, there's this Ellen that I go, who is that? And you're going
to
go, free to be me, baby.
Yeah, me.
And you're not going
to
care what people think or how they respond because it finally clicked and you finally got it that, you know what, I can't control how people respond.
Why
and if I can't, hold on, I'm helping
okay,
you right
okay.
now. And if I can't, then why do I stop myself from just being me and expressing myself the way that I get to?
One of my dilemmas is, it only is with certain people. It's not with everybody. It's with certain people and certain situations.
Are these certain people like people maybe you look up to or you hold them at a higher no
it's family members, young ones.
So I'm gonna ask
you know what's funny is you say young ones. To me, I look up to my elders or my family members that are themselves and they're just free to like just be themselves, confident. They show up in a room and they know how to just be themselves. They're making people laugh. Like those, when I was a young kid, those were family members I looked up to, and I wanted to be like them. I wanted to have the same characteristics as them. So it's funny that you say you hold yourself back from being you when these younger kids in the family want to see you, because that's going to make them be able to let themselves open up and be free as well, and it shares through the generations.
Interesting, huh?
And then what was the question you asked her?
Who was it that she was?
Okay, so now I'm going to ask you a different question.
Okay,
those people that you were talking about, are you afraid that they're not going to love you, accept you, or that they might leave you?
Yes.
Okay, can you control that?
No.
So if you can't control it, why would it stop you from just being yourself and expressing yourself?
You're going to make me cry. It's probably the biggest deal in my life right now.
Okay. Got it. Now,
getting my hands around this.
What Mark is saying is, and what this is what I'm hearing him say, and it, I don't know if you said it or not, but what I was hearing him say was, what you're afraid that's going to happen 98% of the time will probably not happen. And if you lean into that fear and decide to surrender all of them, surrender all those little people that you love more than anything in the world, you got to learn how to surrender that love and say, look, if you choose to not love me, I can't control that, and I'm willing to let it go.
That's big.
I know. And then when you finally surrender that and decide to flip that switch, it frees you up to be able to just be you and express you. And what he was saying is, be open to the possibility of those little ones, when you go to that place, they're going to go, ah, I like that. I want that. And I want to be like that. So it's almost like that which you're afraid of, you're actually afraid of something that if you go there, it'll cause the reverse. It's like we're afraid to get people upset, so we hold back. And we don't realize that if we just leaned into it and trusted it and went with it, we actually inspire those people to want to stay there with us. It's a weird phenomenon. It's like this thing of fear that we as human beings have to master or get to master is that we're so afraid of it, that fear keeps us in the box.
You know, it was so cool to hear Mark say how he grew up, and he had the good fortune of experiencing that. In my family, I didn't have that experience. In my family, you know, if your parents spoke, you listened. Children were to be, you know, seen and not heard. So I didn't grow up with the experience of being able to voice myself, to voice my opinions. It was old-fashioned and structured.
Well,
and
to me, what the beauty in it is you can change that.
Yes.
You know, you're the one to now change that in the family and really evolve the family to another level where everyone in the family is free and open. They can speak their mind and they're not going to be judged. It's going to create a conversation and everyone's going to learn from each other and grow. And that's
it'll take practice. And I think maybe where I'm stumbling a little bit is that the first time is going to be maybe the hardest. But it's just not one and done.
No, for sure not one and done.
You know what I mean?
It's not one and done. However,
I get tied up in that, I think.
But the first one does something to you.
I'm sure it does.
Because what it does is it shatters the, oh, my God, I'm still alive. they're not packing their bags. You know, it's that first one that seems to be the biggest mountain. And then when you finally get there, you go, oh, my God, it's not what I thought it was going to be. Again, this goes back to all the thoughts. It's these limiting beliefs and the thoughts and the fears of, oh, my God. And you already probably have a 10 of them already at the top of your head. They're not going to like me no more. They're not going to want to hang around me. They're going to stop inviting me to places. You probably got like 10 or 15 of those. And when you get there and you finally lean into it and you finally just choose to be free and express yourself, you're going to be looking around for the hammer to fall and it's not going to fall. Or you might have a couple of people upset, kicking things, or you know, but you're going to go, that's it? You're going to shock yourself.
Yeah. And, you know, like you said, and I'm getting really close, whatever happens, happens.
Yeah.
You know, if they pack their bags and leave, they pack their bags and leave.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
That's right.
I get to set myself free.
Yes,
they're the
do.
Ones that will choose whatever they're choosing. I mean, I'm getting so close.
I know you are, and I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of you, and you inspire me, and you're probably inspiring other people to be able to share that, because there's probably hundreds of thousands, if not millions of other people that allow that fear of whatever they think is going to happen or whatever they think the repercussion is going to be, have them be a prisoner of not being able to be themselves and express themselves. And then we wonder why we have all these withholds in us. Then we wonder why we have stress and cancer and all these diseases, because we're like emotionally and spiritually constipated. We can't let stuff out, and so stuff stays stuck in our being, in our essence, in our energy. And I think that this is going to be a huge breakthrough for you. What I realized, though, as you were talking about when you said, I grew up like this, right? When you grew up like that, where you're in an environment where you were to be
seen and not heard. It's the old fashioned.
All right. That environment back then, throw a year out there. I dare you.
50s.
Okay, in the 50s. There was an environment.
Just dated myself.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I said I dare you, and you took it. But in the 50s, there was an environment that had rules, correct?
Lots of them.
Guess what? Those rules aren't set up in today's environment. And you're playing a game with outdated rules. And so,
because I'm trying to be the good girl.
That's
still.
Right. And so you have this young guy telling you that he basically was saying to you, It's not like that anymore.
Wake up to the 21st century, let it go.
When he said those types of people, when they actually have the audacity to just do that, they look at it like, ooh, that's so refreshing. Like, I want to be like that. So the rules are different in today's environment. It's not the 50s anymore. And you have to learn how to shut down all that old programming and all that stuff. That it's not the same game. You're playing a different game with tools you brought in from the 50s, the 60s, and all the way up into present time.
And those people, i.e. my mom and dad, aren't even here anymore.
There you go. Wow. There you go. So imagine carrying that mom and dad fear with you, and it could be stifling your own parenting potential and your own grandparenting potential and your own leadership potential, because you're still carrying stuff around with you that you don't realize you have. From mom and dad.
Oh, I realize I have them. At least I'm aware. Yeah. I'm totally aware, you know, that I have them, and I've been bringing them with me. But I'm identifying them, you know,
right.
And kind of understanding this is where I got this misinformation, and I can turn it around. And it's not like I want to get to the point where I don't care. I want to get to the point where I can say, I care, and I mean something, and I matter. So I can share anything I want to, because I'm not a mean person. So anything that I would choose to say is not intentionally hurtful.
And see, you got to remember that part. That part's important, because if you forget that, I think you forget that in those moments.
I do.
You forget that I'm not a mean person, and nothing comes out of my mouth is intentionally said, or my intentions to do things are never to hurt anybody
ever.
And so I think you forget that in those moments, and so then you tippy-toe, you walk on eggshells, you kind of just scurry around the edges because you're afraid of just
of hurting somebody.
Yes,
because then it
comes
back on me, like,
yes,
why did you hurt that
That's
person
right.
that you love?
But guess what you're always gonna offend someone. You're always gonna hurt someone, not on purpose, not on intention, but because other people have their own God-given ability to interpret their own meaning to whatever it is that they see and experience. And so there are hurt, broken, lost people in the world that interpret things, and they misinterpret our intentions.
And it's not my responsibility.
It's not your responsibility of how they perceive it.
Right.
However, if they matter to you, it might be your responsibility to go and clean it up and explain to them that what your intention was, so that they can go, oh, thank you for clarifying that to me. That lets me know that you do love me. You do care for me. It wasn't about what you said. It was about who you were being afterwards, once you realized that I took it as an offense and
but
I got hurt.
I also know if I tee it up properly.
There you go. See? You're learning now.
That's that just they won't miss it.
That's right. That's the wise part of having offended many people or hurt many people or got people upset at you, is knowing now who they are and what they're about and how delicate they are. Now you can tee it up and go, look, I'm gonna be me.
And I'm gonna share,
and it's going to be raw and honest. And I need you to hear it as though I'm on your team. And it's not a dig.
It's coming from love.
Yeah, and it's just my experience. Now, when you do a beautiful tee up like that, they're listening. Like, all right,
bring it on.
Yeah, they're now hearing it as though you're gonna give them this gift rather than hurting their feelings. All right, we gotta go on a break. Stay tuned for more of the Alex Urbina Radio Show right here in your hometown station, KHTS.
The city of Santa Clarita has so much going on this year. Be on the lookout for amazing events happening throughout the year, including the Cowboy Festival, concerts in the park, Thursdays at Newhall, and the Santa Clarita Marathon. There are also a number of fun activities and things to do year-round, including outdoor recreation, hiking and bike trails, adult classes, art exhibits, youth sports programs, and more. You can even sign up to be a volunteer. Learn more at santa-clarita.com.
The Art Gallery of Santa Clarita Artists Association, located in downtown Newhall on 6th Street between Railroad and Main, features local members' original artwork with changing exhibits every 2 months. Purchase affordable art for your home or as gifts. Open Friday through Sunday or by appointment. Artists wishing to join the SCAA can visit santaclaritaartists.org, come to our free monthly meetings at Barnes & Noble, or stop by the gallery. For upcoming shows, check us out at santaclaritaartists.org. We make visual art visible.
The this is Arita's Daybreak. There's a huge crowd at Arita's. With so many amazing flavors, every day's a treat. Let's see what folks are celebrating.
I lost my first tooth.
No more training wheels.
My dog photo got 37 likes.
Three kids, three activities, zero meltdowns. There you have it. Layer it, blend it, or drink it with Italian ice and creamy custard. So many reasons to celebrate at Arita's. This has been Arita's Daybreak.
Hometown, your hometown station.
And welcome back to the Alex Urbina Radio Show, brought to you by KHTS, your hometown station. And today we're talking about fear and how to not let fear stifle your intentions in life and how to overcome fear. We started the show off with the possibility that fear is a choice. And I know for many people, not really understanding that it could possibly, I think the first step is, could it possibly be a choice? You first got to be open to that. But if you're not open to it, you can't even get down. You can't even get down a little bit further on down the road to having the breakthrough if you're first not open to a possibility that is a choice. I want to point out that it could be a conscious choice to say, you know what, in this moment, I'm not going to be fearful in this, right? It's or recognizing that you have the fear. There's some steps that I'm going to go over of how do I identify it and how to at some point overcome the fear. But I want to first talk about what fear is. It's a feeling that we have, right? And it's this ugly feeling that it's like a knot in your stomach, a knot in your throat. Sometimes it could paralyze us and not really allow us to move.
It's an anxious feeling
for
me.
And a stressful feeling of not really being sure. It's like we're unsure of whatever the outcome is, and so I don't want to move on from that. And when we talk about fear when it comes to danger, because in the beginning of the show we talked about this show's not about the danger fear, but I want to go back to it for a moment, because our ego is this entity that created itself when we were younger, and it decided that it was going to help us manage our life at a certain point, whether we were 3 years old, 5 years old. It came in and said, hey, kid, I'm going to help you. I'm going to protect you from the things that are harmful to you. And the ego is designed in a beautiful way to protect us from fear. Its job is to not let us get hurt. So anytime there's a physical danger, mental danger, emotional danger, any kind of danger that could cause us harm, ego kicks in and goes, hey, remember last time you went down that road? Let's be mindful of it. Let's be aware. Let's keep our eyes open and a head on a swivel. It's the part that comes in and tells you, hey, that's a dark road. You probably shouldn't go down that way. Why don't you take the lighted path? So our ego is designed to come in and save us in those moments. However, in the same breath, if we don't realize that we're in control of ego and ego controls us, then it just runs rampant. Then ego inserts itself in all areas of your life, including your relationships. So here you're married to your beautiful wife or this your handsome husband, and you fell in love with this person, and they want to get to know the deepest part of you, and they want to connect with you, and they want to have a beautiful relationship. But your ego gets in the way if it's not decided that you get to tell the ego to take a seat in the corner. It just steps in and it causes the fear of being hurt. It causes you to fear being rejected. And so what it does is it has you be hesitant in your relationships, and therefore your partner never really gets to experience the full glory and the beauty of having your whole self. And so that's just one example of how our fear and our ego can get in, and just when it runs rampant, it can just sabotage us in those relationships.
Yeah. What I guess, like, you know, for me, what is something you can do to help face those fears when they come up? Like, you know, the ego comes up and the fear comes up, but sometimes, you know, similar to you, I can just fade away and just stay quiet.
Yeah.
You know, like you don't know what to do, so you just stay quiet and you don't express yourself, you don't do those certain things. And I think after time and time, it just, now that becomes the norm. You know, now you just stay there.
Seems easier, less painful.
Yeah, like I guess, you know, what are some ways to like just take that step or jump into it?
So the first thing I'm going to start with is what you shouldn't do, which is what you just brought up, which is do nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So don't do nothing and don't let it paralyze you.
Mm.
You have to inside your head decide that I am in charge. My ego's not in charge. Because if you don't take full charge of your own life in a conscious way, that means unconsciously your ego runs you.
Mm.
And if you're going to let your ego run you, it's going to run you with fear. It's fear-based. That's its job. Remember I said earlier, it's a beautiful gift to have the ego because its job is to protect you and save your life. But unmanaged, uncontrolled, ego just goes in and goes, all right, everywhere we go, we're bringing fear with us. I don't care where we're at. It's because it's just part of its mechanism. So you have to be mindful. You have to practice the art of being mindful, being aware. And instead of not doing something, you have to do something. So the first thing you want to do is start noticing it.
Mm.
So practice for the next 30 days is notice every time I'm afraid.
Every moment that
fear comes up is just notice and observe. Don't judge it.
Mm-hmm.
Just notice. Oh, my God, I'm afraid again.
And you don't really have to do anything. You just have to be aware of it.
That's the first step. It's just notice.
It's like, ooh, there it is.
Just notice it so that you cause a new awareness. That's stage one. If you can cause awareness, now you see it. Now you can change it. If you can't see it and you don't notice it, how are you going to change something?
Yeah.
Right.
All you're doing is noticing it after the fact. You're looking back, like right now, you're looking back at all those fearful moments and you're noticing it after the fact.
Mm-hmm.
But because we're talking about it and you're having the courage to call yourself out, it's causing a new awareness. So that in the next 3 to 5 days, guess what? You're out in your life. And when it comes up, you're going to go, oh, my God, here it is again.
And now I have a choice.
Then all of a sudden, after the noticing, you're going to realize, oh, my God, I actually have a choice. But you can't get to stage two if you can't get to stage one. Stage one is first, and it's a constant awareness of every time you're afraid. And every time you're afraid, you get to ask yourself, is this fear warranted or not warranted? Is my life in danger? No. You're going into an interview.
Yeah.
What's the guy going to do? He's going to say you're not it and stab you?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
So right. Worst thing he can say is, you know,
no,
sorry.
No.
Job's not for you.
And so you get to first be aware of the fear that's coming up. And then from the awareness, you get to decide whether it's harmful or not. If it's not no physical danger or any kind of danger, it's just the kind of fear that stops you from moving forward, then you can decide to reframe it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the reframing might take someone else to help you. Thus having a coach, thus having a mentor, thus having somebody a little bit further on down the road of consciousness to help you understand how to reframe your life. And the more you get good at reframing and creating new perspectives, in those moments after the awareness, you can cause a new reframing, a new story, as we like to talk about. Create a new story. So instead of the story of, oh, my God, he's not going to hire me or she's not going to see my value – you get to walk in there going, you know what? I'm walking in to interview you to see if you're worthy enough to have my skills. Now, if I create a new story in the lobby, am I afraid to walk into that interview now?
No.
Absolutely not. I'm walking in like I'm it. And if I believe in my skills and I know what I'm capable of, that might actually, me walking in like that, I might be the one out of the 3,000 people they've interviewed that they go, there's something about you we like.
Yeah. What I learned is everyone can be qualified. Everyone has the same, you know, schooling, same amount of years. And it's not really about how much schooling. It's about the experience you create with, you know, the person that you're interviewing with. And if they like you, they can choose you over anyone else that's more experienced than you or,
You know, people do business with people they like. It's real simple.
Yeah.
Like you say, a lot of, you know, you go to a particular restaurant, you know, a lot of restaurants serve the same thing.
Yeah.
But if you walk into one and it just has a good vibe and it's got a good energy, that's where you're going to go.
That's right.
So
yeah.
As a human, if you got a good vibe and a good energy, that's going to come across and someone's going to say, I think I'll choose you.
Yeah. Now, if the scenario that I just painted about you causing a perspective shift or creating a different narrative or a different framework before you walk in, if that's a little bit more advanced and you don't have coaching or a coach or anyone to help you learn how to create that for yourself, let's dial it back a little bit. Maybe there's stages in before that where you just learn how to be honest about having the fear. And so maybe a stage looks like you're walking in, letting the person know, hey, my name's Alex, nice to meet you, just want to let you know I got some nerves right now. I'm nervous. I'm afraid.
Because I want this so much.
That's right. See, there you go.
Actually opens
yeah,
up.
Yeah. And so there's another stage before that where you can just be honest and use it as an opportunity to be authentic. And you never know, that might inspire someone to go, you know, I like that. You're the only one that I got all these people coming in acting like they're
pounding
not
their chest.
Acting like they're not afraid, but I can hear it in their tone. I can see it in their inauthenticity. I like that you came in and just embraced it. And I'm looking for honest, authentic people like you.
Yeah. I could share an experience where even, you know, I was on a first date and I really liked her and I just told her, like, I'm super nervous. I actually really like you and I'm nervous. And she, you know, she actually was like, oh, that's super cute. Like, it opened up a whole different, you know, feeling.
You could, like, breathe, right? Like, okay.
Yeah, yeah. She wasn't like, oh,
and then
this.
And based on her reaction, I bet you that settled you down.
Yeah, of course.
It was like, oh.
I don't have to hold that.
Yeah. It's like how she responded to it kind of puts you at ease.
It's amazing when you don't do that, because I experience this all the time working hard on it, is I hold a lot. I just hold it, and it will be the most glorious day when I'm not holding it anymore.
Mm. Yeah.
And I know it's coming.
Absolutely. All right, so let's get into, all right, how do we support you in dealing with your fear, not letting it run you, right? I threw down some notes, so we're just going to talk about those. Number one is, first, you got to acknowledge it. You got to be honest and be willing to go, all right, I'm afraid. That's number one. There's a lot of people that are like, no, I'm not afraid. And it's like, bro, I can. You're biting your nail. Like, people, you don't think people are watching you, or you don't think people have an energy thermometer.
They certainly do.
They're sensing you. They can tell, right? Just, all right, I'm nervous. All right, just own it. So own it, acknowledge it, be willing to embrace it. Then from that, there's a stage where you seek to understand why. Why am I nervous? And being in the question, could it be this? Could it be that? For you, you got clear on it's the fear of people not loving me, people leaving me, people being upset at me. So it's kind of, let's seek to understand why I would be afraid, okay? So that's number two. After those two, my recommendation is find a coach. And this is why, not because I'm a coach, but because I've gotten coached and have been coached for 25 years of my life. What a coach has done for me is help me understand why. And then they've been really good at finding other perspectives to throw at me that I never considered. There's nothing more amazing than having some fear, and you go to your coach or your mentor, and you go, oh, my God. And they put their arm around you, and they're like, kid, have you ever considered this? Have you ever looked at it like that? Have you? And you're just like, oh, my God, where do you get this from?
I know. I do that all the time.
I love that, right? And the only reason why, not because they're more special than you that they see it, is just because they're not in your shoes feeling the fear.
Right.
I think also, too, is they may have just had an experience that you never had.
That's
yet,
right.
Or they may have just had, you know, something that they can offer you. And what's, you know, the beauty in it is, if, you know, you live your life, I live my life, and you're able to help me, you know, guide me with a couple insights that I've never experienced before, it's beautiful, because now I'm, instead of me waiting to get to your age to experience those things, I can experience them now prior to even waiting 10 years to.
How do we get young people
to understand that.
To understand that and want that. I'm waiting for the day that young people, and it might not even be in my lifetime, but I'm waiting for the day that young people see the value of having a mentor. I don't know if it's not cool, if it's the rampantness of the millennials and the I generation still trying to overcome the know-it-allism that they swim around in.
Oh my gosh.
But that know-it-allism doesn't allow them to just go to grandpa and go, hey grandpa, I need to pick your brain. Like, why, you know what I mean? Like, they're not seeking out wisdom from other people to go,
you got 50 years on me.
I want this.
Tell me about
this. Like, yeah.
Well, maybe it's because those people are not being authentic or being themselves.
Could be.
You know, so
they're fearful.
They're holding their fears in. It's both people are holding their fears.
Yeah.
The kids are afraid to ask, and the parents are afraid to tell.
Because the fear in these young kids who know everything.
And most of them do. They're smart.
Yeah. You know, but they have no life skills.
Exactly.
But they think they know everything. And so to ask a question or to say, how do I do this, in their little brains right now, it tells them, oh, you know, you're not as smart as you thought you were.
Yeah.
So just be quiet.
Yeah, one of the favorite things that I loved about growing up and learning with you as my father was you would tell me not to do it. You would give me advice, and I would purposely do it because I knew I wanted to experience it myself. Even though I know you told me, like, don't do it. I've done this before. Listen to me. I've been through it. I can help you.
You made a choice.
I can help you not make the same mistakes as me. But as a young kid, I was like, you know what? I understand that, but I need to experience this for myself, because if I don't do it now,
can do it later.
It may happen later. So let me experience it for myself.
And I think that's the code for all kids.
Yeah.
I think for majority of kids, they're not that wise to go, oh my God, because you're telling me this, I'm gonna take this in. And yeah, they're the ones that you say, don't touch that stove because it's hot.
As soon as
you turn your back, you go,
that's right.
You're
right.
And so,
but that's part of growing up.
Absolutely, exactly, absolutely. Exactly. And the funny thing is, as you're sharing that, I knew you were gonna do it anyways. Because guess why?
Because you did it.
Because I did it too.
Exactly.
But I wanted to be able to give you the option, because when I was a kid, I might not have had somebody that said, "Hey, if you touch that stove." So I appreciate, because out of 10 times that I give you that insight, you might have only wanted 8. To see for yourself.
Yeah.
3 of them you might have went, all right, I trust my dad.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Those other 8 proved to me that the other 3,
right,
I can actually trust you and not.
And then in the next set of 10, instead of only trust me on 3, you trusted me on 4.
Yeah.
And the next set of 10, it was 5. Until
then
the point.
Then you start just trusting yourself.
That's
exactly
right. There you go. Because at some point, my voice becomes your voice.
Right.
And then my insight becomes your insight. And so then you just become more aware of it. Mm-hmm. The next thing I want to talk about is opening up the possibility of embracing your fear. After you acknowledge it, after you seek to understand it, what if we learned how just to embrace it? And after you embrace it, you have to learn how to dance with it. This is something that was taught to me when I was a young man in my early stages of consciousness and personal development in my journey. One of my coaches says, you have to learn how to dance with your fears. And I was like, what does that mean?
What does that look like?
And it wasn't until I started to learn how to accept it, be honest with it, embrace it, then all of a sudden the next stage was learning how to dance with it. Dancing with it is similar to carrying it with me wherever I go. And I visualize sometimes I'm there, and if I'm nervous, I can – okay, so if I'm afraid of something, I'm in the hallway, right, and kind of embracing my fear. Dancing with it, to me, is like transitioning it from – a fear to a worry to a concern. So as I'm dancing with it, I embrace the fear, I'm dancing with it, I'm spinning it, it turns now into a worry. And I'm dancing with it, spin it around, and now it's a concern. And if you can understand the distinctions between having a concern, and then a concern at the next level turns into a worry, and then the worry ends up ultimately turning into a fear.
Yeah, I get that.
And then the fear ultimately turns into anxiety. And the anxiety turns up into depression and suicide.
Stress,
and I mean, it just, they're different stages or different distinctions. And I think most of us, no one teaches us those distinctions. So with ego, it just teaches us how to go straight to fear. We bypass concern and worry. One of the greatest gifts that I've learned how to teach myself is to learn how to dial back my fear into a worry and then dial it back into a concern. When it's a concern, I can put it on the shelf and I can still live my life being concerned about something, but it's not a worry and it's not a fear anymore. Because worry and fear takes so much energy from me.
Yes.
A concern is just something that I got to just keep looking, keep notice. It's like a check-in. Yeah. Check-in. Yeah. All right. Check-in.
Still concerned.
Yeah, okay. After the seventh check-in, it went to another level. Okay, now I'm a little worried. And then the worry now might cause me to be proactive to step in there and cause a different result. But if I'm looking at it and hanging around the fear paralyzes you. And
yes, it does.
And it clouds your decision making. And you're not a very effective leader if you operate from fear. But if you're a powerful leader, you're going to operate from a place of concern and then probably dance between concern and worry. Those are powerful energies that get you, they're creative energies. Mm. It's like, okay, what can we do different about it now? All right, it is what it is. Now what? Let's figure out how to come up with a solution. A lot of times when you're hanging out in fear, you can't. You're not creative.
No.
Yeah.
You're full on resistance.
Yeah.
You're with blinders.
You're with blinders on.
Yeah.
All right. Stay tuned for more of challenging our fears and overcoming right here on your hometown station, KHTS.
Hey, all you savvy style seekers. Extraordinary deals on designer brands await you at the outlets at DeHome. Find the latest fashion and accessories at Michael Kors, H&M, Levi's Outlet Store, Coach, and Calvin Klein. Shop for the whole family at Gap Outlet, American Eagle Outfitters, Oshkosh Bagosh, and Nike Factory Store. Even style your home with Pottery Barn Outlet and Le Creuset. All at amazing everyday value you won't find anywhere else. Join our VIP club today to receive your free coupon brochure filled with hundreds of dollars in additional savings. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Or visit DeHomeOutlets.com for the latest sales and events. Your must shop stop is located just 40 minutes north on I-5.
3 days of shopping, 3 days of saving. Shop your style at the Outlets at DeHome President's Day Super Sale for extra savings on your favorite brands like H&M, Nike, Kate Spade, Gap Outlet, Express Factory Store, and more. DeHomeOutlets.com.
Marston's Restaurant has been a Pasadena landmark, voted the best breakfast in California by the Food Network magazine. Discover Marston's Santa Clarita location, open for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Marston's also has a fantastic catering menu that adds a delicious twist to any event. And they cater picnic dinners for that memorable romantic date. Experience Marston's on Newhall Ranch Road and McBean, or log on to marstonsrestaurant.com.
Hi, this is Kirk Stinson with Plumbing by Kirk, your hometown plumber. By this time, you should know where all your gas and water shutoff valves are in case of an emergency. If you don't, you should call Plumbing by Kirk. Our friendly staff will be more than happy to set an appointment for one of our technicians to come to your home and clearly mark all your shutoff valve locations. We invite you to visit our website for free plumbing advice at plumbingbykirk.com or give us a call, 263-6519. That's 263-6519.
My dad is the best plumber ever. Call Plumbing by Kirk.
Your hometown station, KHTS.
And welcome back to the Alex Urbina Radio Show, right here in your KHTS hometown station. Today we're talking about fear and how to overcome your fear, how to not let your fear paralyze you. During the break, Mark, you were telling us a little bit about how you've transcended fear, which is a whole nother area of when you have fear. Earlier I was talking about how I take my fear and I scale it back or downscale it. That's fear shows up and I learn how to downscale it down. What you're talking about is having a fear and then transcending it or converting it. It's almost like creating something next to it, mm-hmm. like sideways. Mm-hmm. So talk to us a little bit about how you've trained yourself or designed fear in a specific way where it created like an offspring, and then now you have mm-hmm. a different relationship to that kind of fear now, or it doesn't paralyze you.
Yeah, so my experience with fear is, you know, things that I may not be good at, or, you know, similar to, like you said, I may get judged for doing this thing. And what I've learned is when I step into it, I'm actually, you know, people actually praise me, like, yo, that was really cool, or this is really good, we like this, and we like this version of you, or, you know, it's actually something that people look at as a good thing. So my experience is every time I've stepped into this moment of fear, not knowing if I can do it or not knowing if I could be the person to make that happen, I actually do make it happen, and it actually works out in my favor. So for me, when I see fear, it actually gets me excited because I'm able to create something new that I've never done before.
Absolutely.
And based on, you know, my results and experience, people have accepted me for it because I'm just confident and capable to take on anything that's in front of me. And like I said, it just became a thing where I enjoy stepping into fear because I know there's growth and I know there's something there for me to learn.
Fear's not a four-letter word. It's not a bad word. Yeah. I think, you know.
Well, it is until you learn that it's not.
Until you reframe it.
until someone teaches you or you decide for yourself that it's not.
It's an opportunity.
But I think we're just born into this world believing that fear is a bad thing,
right,
and it is something that's scary, and it is, and we define it unconsciously to where it limits us.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What you're talking about is what I was talking about earlier in the show when I talked about leaning into it. When fear comes up, if you can trust yourself and trust the universe, the higher power, if you can trust something outside of
yourself
that says, if I just lean into it, let's see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
And what you started to do is you started to lean into the fear. And then from leaning in, you decided, hey, leaning in is there's something there to
yeah.
it. That's that
you
I
started
that
creating
yeah,
actual
yeah.
real results that
that's right.
I've always wanted.
And from the leaning, you graduated to stepping into.
That's so cool. It's really cool
so,
to hear.
So it's
been a journey for sure.
I'll bet.
Yeah.
So leaning in, now you graduate to now I learn how to step into my fear. And stepping into my fear, I can carry it with me and use it as a motivating factor to be that little. It's like you converted fear into passion. Now
yeah.
I'm passionate about what I'm doing. And does it scare me? Yeah.
Definitely.
But what scares me is just the unknown.
Yeah.
But the unknown is just the unknown. That's it. And so.
But that's, to me, it's unknown until I make it
that's
known.
That's right.
And that's when I can step into it.
That's the
it.
Part that excites you. It's like, oh, it's unknown?
Yeah.
That means it's a blank slate.
Exactly.
That means I can create whatever I want.
Exactly.
But what most people do is when they doubt themselves, then they go, if I can create whatever I want, what if, here's where the what ifs come in. What if I don't create something good enough?
Yeah.
Then the fear is even doubled.
Yeah.
So you have to have a little bit of confidence in yourself to go.
It just takes
I'm just
one
gonna,
or two.
No, absolutely.
Yeah.
And this is what I talk about in the trainings a lot of times, whether it's a teen training or any training I'm doing. We go over the distinction of the comfort zone. Mm. And that growth doesn't happen inside the comfort zone, because inside the comfort zone, it's safe, it's warm, it's the warm and fuzzies, the foo-foo. Right? There's no fear inside your comfort zone. Fear is designed to be outside your comfort zone, and you have to learn how to get out of your comfort zone and get into the fear zone. Because
mm-hmm.
fear zone is where new things are born out of, new discoveries, new greatness. It's where creativity really happens, is outside of your comfort zone. And this is what we need to be teaching our young people,
yes.
is how to reinvent
mm-hmm.
this fear that we were born into, and no one ever taught us how to see it that way, so that I can learn how to embrace fear, dance with it, carry it with me into wherever I'm going,
yeah.
and be freed up to create whatever I want, whatever my heart desires.
I think something super important as a parent that is helpful, I'm just, you know, coming up with this, is you can't tell me, you know, you can't really break down that distinction of fear and my comfort zone and me really understand it as a kid, as a young person. You just don't know. You don't have enough experience yet to understand it. But what you can do is open up conversations with your kids. So when they do go through those things, they're able to come to you and share it with you. And then you're able to now let them in on that little secret. Like, oh, that was really good that you did that. How did you feel? You know,
navigating.
Yeah, helping them navigate. Helping them actually relate of the concepts that you want to teach them through experiences that they're having in their own life.
Yeah.
And I think that's super important. And that doesn't happen unless you open up dialogue consistently with, you know, your kids or your family.
It's true. So earlier I was talking about acknowledging first, being honest about the fear, and then seeking to understand it, right? And then it was go find a coach so they can help you find a perspective to reframe it for you. The next one is embracing your fear, learning how to accept it. The next one is what you just talked about, which is learning how to move through it. Starts off first maybe with leaning in, then stepping into it, but you're actually learning how to move through your fear. And if you don't know how to do that, you got to find a coach so your coach can help open perspectives for you to see it a different way. Because if you can't see it a different way,
nothing's
we can
happen.
Talk about this forever, and you're going to go back to, like, you're like, I know it conceptually, when I'm there, it just comes
and
up.
I can't move.
And it overwhelms me, right?
Yeah.
Here's another big one. You have to get to a point in your life where you decide that you're bigger than your fear. This was a stage and a process that I got to in my journey of personal development. And it's you just, at a certain point, you decide, I'm bigger than my fear. But before that, you go through a stage called I'm bigger than my circumstances. Being bigger than your circumstances is like a mindset. It's a come from. So it's like if I'm on my way somewhere and I get a flat tire, that flat tire is not going to stop me from getting to my destination. I'm bigger than my circumstances. When you practice that, you become bigger than your fears, and you end up transcending your life and being the leader that you were born to be. Thank you guys for being here. Appreciate you.
Of course.
We're signing
Great.
Off. Thank you. We're out.